Are you of the mind that all singularities are analytic, or is it just black hole singularities?
No, it's absolutely fascinating. So great question. What distinguishes the Big Bang singularity from the one inside black holes is that at least if the Big Bang was dominated by radiation, right, the fields which have this special local symmetry, if that is what dominated the Big Bang, as observations seem to indicate, then the Big Bang singularity was analytic. It was smooth. When you say something is an analytic function, you can extrapolate it. You see, so if you have, say, a linear function hitting zero, you know, just y equals x, and you tell me y is an analytic function of x, well, it's no problem to extrapolate it. You know, y is x, and that applies when x is negative as well. So analytic functions have this property of being able to be extrapolated in a completely unique way. So that's what we discovered, that the solution of Einstein's equations describing a radiation dominated Big Bang are analytic at t equals zero, and they have a unique extension to this pre-bang era. If you look at black holes, that is not true. So the singularity inside a black hole is totally different. It's what's called, it's very anisotropic. You know, as you head towards a singularity in a inside a black hole, you get squished in one direction and stretched in the other two. It's very anisotropic, and this actually means it's not analytic, and you cannot forecast what comes out the other side. It's just impossible to forecast. Now, in very recent work, which is not yet published, we have been trying to extend our notion of analytic solutions of the Einstein equations to black holes. And you can ask yourself, if a usual description of a black hole is not an analytic solution of the Einstein equations, is there one which is? Is there some other description of black hole which does describe it as an analytic solution of the Einstein equations? And the answer is, I think, this is still tentative, I think there is. And what happens is that as you head towards the event horizon, there's some matching process that basically when I fall into the event horizon, I would come out of another event horizon, and I would never actually fall into the black hole. This is what we're studying now. So it means there's some other prescription for solving the Einstein equations, which does not mean that when you fall into a black hole, you fall in and hit the singularity. Because I believe that these singularities, you see, the thing about this type of singularity, which is non-analytic, it does not solve the Einstein equations. The equations fail there. So you cannot claim this is a solution. And if there's sort of any justice in the world, which I think there will be, the principle that the Big Bang singularity is analytic, that is telling us that we need to concentrate on solutions of the Einstein equations, which are analytic.
Okay, wonderful, because my next question was going to be, if the universe is analytic at, say, the zero point of the Big Bang, and analyticity implies that there's an analytic solution which can be extended from the origin arbitrarily.
Yes.
Then why would it be that a black hole isn't analytic, given that it's presumably at some other space-time point?
Yeah, so let me put this in another sort of framework. Our picture is that you take a big universe and its mirror image, and you ask yourself, is there any solution of the Einstein equations which joins the two? And I will only call it a solution if it's analytic, because then it really solves the equation. If it's non-analytic, then it's ambiguous. It's inherently ambiguous. And why this is so important, it actually relates to path integrals and saddle point theory. you know, the classical solutions of the Einstein equations are called saddle points of the path integral for gravity. It means that basically they are a history in which the destructive interference is canceling out. So classical physics arises through destructive interference from quantum physics. In quantum physics, you sort of add up all possible histories, but they all come with different phases, and typically they all cancel out. So destructive interference cancels out the contributions of all histories except classical ones. Classical ones are defined to be histories where there is no destructive interference. That all goes away. And basically, something is only a legitimate saddle point if it is analytic. Okay, so we're claiming the Big Bang singularity is a legitimate saddle point. In other words, it's not really singular, it's because it's analytic. When I go to a black hole, and if I believe that black holes form and then evaporate, which we believe based on Hawking's calculations of black hole evaporation, it must be that there is some analytic history solution of the Einstein equations, which interpolates between the stuff falling in to make the black hole and the stuff coming out as Hawking radiation when the black hole has gone away. So there must be an analytic solution. No one has ever found this solution, but with our ideas of CPT symmetry, we now have some hints as to what that kind of solution might look like. And if we do succeed in finding it, the physical interpretation of a black hole may be very different than the classical one based on the singular solution. You know, the classical one says you just fall into the black hole and you're scrunched to zero, and then that's the end of time, you know. So that's the conventional description of what happens in a black hole. If what we're saying is right, I suspect, and I don't have the maths for this yet, but I suspect that as you approach the event horizon of a black hole, everything becomes much more quantum. You'll go through some realm in which things are very quantum, and then you'll come out in a region of space-time in which everything is sort of classical again.
What do you mean you'll go through some realm which is quantum?
Okay, so the analog is So the simple analog is quantum tunneling. So in quantum tunneling, so imagine I've got a particle in a potential, and the potential has a minimum followed by a barrier. And so imagine a potential which kind of comes down to a minimum, goes up to a maximum, and then goes down to arbitrary negative values. So I put a particle in this potential well. And if it's got some energy, it can rattle around in the well, but it can't get out. Classically, it can't get out. Quantum mechanically, it tunnels. Quantum mechanically, it can travel under the barrier and come out the other side. And that's how atomic nuclei decay, right? The nucleons, the protons and neutrons, are all stuck in a potential well, but occasionally one of them tunnels out. An alpha particle tunnels out of a radioactive nucleus like uranium and just flies off to infinity. So in quantum tunneling, what happens is that you do not solve the real equations of motion. I'm using real in the sense of complex analysis. If you put a particle in a potential well with a certain energy and just leave it in there, it will stay there forever, classically. Quantum mechanically, it doesn't stay there forever. It tunnels out. And the way it tunnels out is because it follows a complex solution of the same equations, for example, under the barrier, the wave function is falling exponentially. And that's described by saying that the momentum is imaginary. The particle has imaginary momentum. So e to the ipx is actually e to the minus, you know, kappa x, where kappa is real. That only happens because p is I times kappa. Mm-hmm. So quantum tunneling is mediated by complex classical solutions. And so if the right description of a black hole is that it has these two sort of very classical regions in the far past, far future, but in the middle, you have this much more sort of quantum object, it's quite plausible that that is described by a complex space-time, whatever that means. Okay, so nobody has ever found this. It's very, very hard calculation to do. But I think my guess is it will exist. My guess is there will exist an accurate description of the formation and evaporation of black holes, but it's one where the real classical solution of, you know, stuff falling in and then hitting a singularity, that's, in my view, that will be irrelevant. That's not a real black hole because it doesn't solve the Einstein equation. It's not the saddle point of any path integral. Mm-hmm. It doesn't make sense quantum mechanically. I mean, quantum mechanically makes no sense for time to end. Principle in quantum mechanics is that evolution is unitary.
Right.
You know, you just see everything evolves with a phase. But everything, if you hit a singularity, you know, time stops. That doesn't make any sense. So now, if this picture is true, it, of course, will be very exciting because it'll mean that there should be real predictions for the behavior of black holes on scales of their event horizon. And we're now seeing these, right, with telescopes for the first time. You can actually see the event horizon. So, I think we have to come up with a consistent picture of what's going on in black holes. And if we do, it will make definite predictions, hopefully, that can be tested. But, right. You know, as you can tell, this is the whole program we're pursuing is kind of extremely minimal and ambitious. We're taking only the laws that we know and the particles we are confident exist, and we're trying to describe everything we see using those laws. You see, to put it differently, why would you ever do anything else? I mean, minimalism is a very profound principle in science.
And in decorating.
And in everything. Occam's razor. You know, if you have a choice between a simple explanation or a complicated one, go for the simple one. It's much more useful. I mean, and as you make descriptions more and more complex, they become less and less predictive and more and more arbitrary. And this is exactly what's happened with string theory, supersymmetry, grand unified theories. They become more and more complicated. So I'm taking the extreme opposite position. I'm saying just forget about all those frameworks. They never predicted anything anyway. Let's work with what we know and see what is the minimal resolution of these things.
If you enjoyed this Toll clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toll Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toll community. You'll also receive my top 10 Tolls. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.